The 2022 Virtual Business Conference, February 24. Len Simard, Heartfelt Leadership and Prize-Winning Staff Performance.
Everybody, I want to welcome you to the final session of the USPTA Southern Business Seminar. We've had a great afternoon. We saved the best for last for today. We have Len Simard with us. He's a USPTA Master Pro. He's been in our industry for over 35 years. Len currently is in charge of the Racket Sports, Fitness, and General Manager / COO Search Executive with KKW. He'll be giving us a really good hour on heartfelt leadership and prize-winning staff performance. I'd like to introduce Len Simard, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Matt. I know I won't be an hour, so you don't have to worry about submitting yourself that kind of fortitude towards this. So bear with me. But thank you for having me too. It's an honor to be here and speaking with so many division people. It's great to be back with the USPTA talking about it. I just returned from late last night from the CMA conference in San Diego, and it's nice to see live interaction going on there with so many people, a little over 2,000 people, not like it used to be, but it's on its way back, and it's always nice to see that coming back to life again. And there's light at the end of the tunnel and so many new ideas. Actually, 30% of all the education over the last 4 or 5 days was on employee retention, but more so even hiring. So a little bit of this will overlap with a lot of the education that was being presented there. And sure enough, this is on all of our minds, no matter whether you are a board of directors looking to hire a GM or senior staff or even recruit some fellow board members and with a nominating committee, or whether you're hiring a GM or whether you're a GM hiring a tennis director or rackets director. And certainly, and most importantly, and most difficultly, is GMs hiring assistant professionals and head professionals, because it is the toughest market that I have ever seen in my career of 40 plus years. So hopefully some of these ideas will be in your strike zone. I'm sure many of them you're using already, but nonetheless, you might pick up a thing or two, and I hope that's the case. As Matt mentioned, I'm with Copland, Keebler, and Wallace, and very proud to be with them. Those are our partners, Dick Copland being the founder. 26 years old now, more than 400 years of experience on our firm. As you can see, I pretty much do all of the rackets. I do fitness and wellness, some golf directors, and quite a few GMs. In racket centric type clubs, and that's been keeping me busy. It's the busiest that we have ever seen in our 26 years. We're averaging probably about 60 jobs on our website right now, and I think 7 or 8 directors of rackets or head professional jobs going there right now. But we have everything from help for a candidate writing resumes to portfolios and everything in between. You can see we just added Michael Smith too, so we continue to grow regularly. I wanted to start off with this little clip because it is on heartfelt leadership, and I think everybody will probably recognize this, but it's just a nice, I think, fun way to kind of kick Manchester it off a little City bit. You might remember how this Richmond all started
in the Premier League is over,
and then how it actually was looked at that time.
And blow. Whoa.
So look, I'm good. Thank you. Hey, y'all played a heck of a game out there. We may not have won, but y'all definitely succeeded. I mean, you gave the champs 90 minutes of hell. Zero, where you at? That dude had more saves than a Baptist preacher. Give it up for Zero. Yep. That's right. What about Roy? Roy chased down his grandson. Stopped him from getting an easy one. Now, look, this is a sad moment right here for all of us. There ain't nothing I can say standing in front of you right now that can take that away. But please, do me this favor, will you? Lift your heads up and look around this locker room. Yeah? Look at everybody else in here. And I want you to be grateful that you're going through this sad moment with all these other folks. Because I promise you, there is something worse out there than being sad, and that is being alone and being sad. Ain't nobody in this room alone. Sam, do you remember what animal has the shortest memory?
The goldfish.
That's right. The goldfish. Sam, what do you think we should all do once we get done being sad and or angry about this situation?
I think we should all be a goldfish.
I agree.
Let's be sad now. Let's be sad together. And then we can be a gosh darn goldfish.
So here we have a catastrophic loss. The team is in, you know, dire straits, and sure enough, we can find some sort of positive reality in it. And it's really a way of him coming through and say, hey, this was horrible, but boy, there was good things that came about from what we did. And I think that we all, you know, if we've seen that movie before, it was pretty moving. And a fantastic way, to, I think, to start this. So why do we really love him in this show? You know, it brings the team together after a devastating loss. And it's all about bringing the team together, as we know. So what is really leadership versus heartfelt leadership? And of course, there's so many different ways of determining what leadership is. One of the basic ones is, of course, just the art of motivating a group of people to act forward toward achieving a common goal. Well, that's pretty basic. And I think we all kind of do that in our roles, whether we're directors or head professionals or assistant professionals, whoever we're working with, we try and do that. But really taking a good hard look in today's world, we need to have heartfelt leadership, because that's what our clients, our employees, it's what everybody is needing, not just wanting, but needing. And I think that if we can do that, I can't tell you how many times I have search committees that say, hey, you know, I know we're doing a director of tennis or racket search, but do you have any tips for us on how to hire the assistant pros? We all need more pros, and supply and demand is just off the charts with clubs skyrocketing and wait lists and popularity, and we don't have enough staff to really take care of them. The best clubs in America, however, do seem to find them, and they are really flourishing. So again, it's just like when the pandemic was going, and clubs that spent money instead of backing off and cutting and furloughing employees, and all of a sudden, there was a lot of great employees out there. If you remember back in those days, all the best clubs were scooping up all of those furloughed employees. That was one thing. They were also spending money to make sure when the rebranding came about, they were ready to go. And their clubs exploded with popularity and patrons and members. So, of course, you know, what does heart-led leadership means? It's something that is very earnest, sincere, and deeply felt. How are we going to create that particular experience for the employee that they can't get from somewhere else? And that's really the only way to do it, because money isn't the thing anymore that really does it. In my era, that was it, you know, titles and money. Now it's really not the case with Gen Zs and millennials. It's really not. And our future is, I'm sorry, with Gen Xers, and then our future is Gen Zs, which even care only about quality of life and the happiness in what they're doing every day. So speaking of that, you know, one of the things that, you know, I really believe in this book, I've read it, I've bought it for my staff, I've given it to my staff, I've I don't mandate that they read it, but I hope that they do. Jackie and Three Carpenter, good friends of ours and of KKW, and we've known them for a long time. Jackie's actually the editor of the Private Club Advisor, and Three has been a GM in our industry for many, many years. And of course, you know, their whole people first analogy has done very well for them. It's actually been their way of getting to where they are, and very highly accomplished professionals in their respective careers. And, you know, I would highly recommend to buy that book for your staff. And it doesn't mean it's just for the leaders. It's also good to flip it around too. It's great for your employees to actually understand what you're trying to do with them. It's okay. You don't have to be so creative that you're saying, oh my goodness, you know, the director is brilliant. No, we use people's, you know, things that work and allow them to, because it could pass us down, and they're going to do it with whoever they work with, even if they're not working for them. And the whole premise, if we had to cut through the chase of the book of People First, is about love. And it's about loyalty. What will you give? If you give your loyalty to your employees, guess what? They will give it back. They will give it back. If you allow them to own their position, and that was the toughest thing that I've done. And when I talk to directors nationwide, they feel the same way. It's very tough. They, you know, again, a lot of people say, well, I like to do everything myself and I have problems with delegation. The most successful employers in the industry have allowed their employees to take ownership of their job, their duties, their responsibilities. And if you allow them to do that, it'll come back in spades. Obviously, the value portion of it, you know, if you value them, they are going to value the position, the organization, the club. So you have to value them in everything that you do, asking for their advice, going through that. We'll hit on that a little bit more in a minute or two. But extremely important concepts there. And of course, you know, excellence. If you are an excellent leader for them, they will be an excellent employee for you. So if you had to be really simplistic with the entire book or this word of love, it's really about, to make it as simple as possible, what are we saying? That we need to bring love into the workplace. A little different than what you might think in love is, but this is really the new concepts and the new ideas for creating all of these things and happy employees that are staying, take ownership, responsibility, value their job, and ultimately create excellence. Now, where Jackie and Three got a number of their ideas from, although they certainly didn't need it, but a good friend of ours as well, is Tommy Spaulding. And this was the first book that I gave my staff, I'm going to say 3 years ago. And it's called The Heart-Led Leader. Again, a little playoff on this talk on the heartfelt leader. But it's a little bit, it's about what happens between the head and the heart and the 18 inches that are there. It's not very far apart. And we need to get to that heart part. The big difference in his book is he goes through a bunch of Fortune 500 executives and CEOs and gives examples and how they turned around failing companies by really focusing on being heartfelt or a servant leadership style and all about the employees. I know one of my favorite owners that I've had, I am doing something still a little bit in the rackets world, although 95% of my time is spent with search and consulting, I still am in advisory capacity for an indoor racket club in New Canaan, Connecticut. One of the owners, every time he sees me or anyone on the team, from the desk person to the maintenance crew all the way up, I want to thank you for being a part of our team. I want to thank you for being part of our family. And I'm so happy that you're in our lives. Think about that. They're not asking how things are going or why wasn't this put away or whatever it was. We're so thankful that you are in our lives. So it's gone beyond the job and it's almost become a spiritual thing that they actually feel that is more important because that will drive success. Well, when I hear that, and if you think about it yourself, what would you want to do then for that owner or for that board member or for that general manager? If somebody is just saying to you, we're so happy that you're on our team and part of our family and part of our culture. I know I want to just do better without being told to do better. I want to go out there and do something new and do something creative to make him proud of those comments that he made. So think about that when you're going through your day and dealing with your employees, when you want to scold them for something because something wasn't done right, but you pick the other way of talking about it and see the difference in the results. So what are we really forgetting as leaders, or what do employees really want in today's world? And we'll spend a little bit of time with this, but without question, empathy is one of the key areas. I've always said, hey, if you don't take a personal interest in your staff, and I don't mean how they're teaching or how they're greeting a member or the 10-foot rule that they have to say hello to someone or whatever it be, but I mean a personal interest and take true, genuine empathy in their life. I always remember a story where it was a rainy day when I was working at a club in New Canaan, Connecticut. And I asked 10 or 11 staff people, I said, okay, you're still coming into work. Bring your checkbook. No idea what we were talking. They had no idea what we were doing. We actually went down to TD Ameritrade in Stamford, Connecticut. I made every single person open up an IRA, whether it was a Roth IRA or a traditional IRA, they had to open one if they didn't have one. Now, we didn't have 401k, so clearly if you had a 401k, that would be probably even the best idea. But I made everybody do it, whether that was putting $25 down and they had to take $25 out of their paycheck every month to help them look forward to their future, their financial future too. So it's not just about them and their performance and them and their family and them and liking what they do, but it's taking care of them, looking that holistically. How am I going to help this person? And we know in our world, we're not the most brilliant with financial decisions. So helping, unless they've got a parent or a mentor that's really doing that, they'll look for you for it. So every kind of 90% of U.S. workers believe empathy leadership leads to higher job satisfaction. Think about that. Just being empathetic. 55% of workers are actually quit their jobs because their leader wasn't empathetic to work or personal life struggles. And there's some more statistics on that in a moment. So what makes an empathetic leader, you know, being open and transparent when you're dealing with your employees, open and transparent, don't hide anything, involve them. You can't involve them in everything, but everything that you can, make sure they're aware that there's a CapEx project coming. Make sure that they're aware that we are going to reinvest money that came into something that's going to be great for the members, which in turn will help you in dealing with the members. Being fair, don't play favorites. It's got to be fair across the board. What you do for one has to be for the other. So when you make a decision, make sure that you've played it out in your mind all the way through for each different area, department, and employee. Encourage others to share their opinion. Number one of the top three reasons why XZs and millennials are looking for the next job. They want to be valued. They want to be heard. They want to be listened to. It's not about the money anymore. Sure, money's important, but it's not as much about money. Are they trusted to handle delicate conversations. Again, it goes back to the love quote and people first. Empower them to make decisions. Some of the best organizations in the world, the Ritz-Carltons or something, they have a $2,000, a lot of you may know this, but they have a $2,000 slush fund for every employee, for every situation. The employee, even a front desk employee, is allowed to spend up to $2,000 to rectify a situation or a problem that might have existed with a customer or a patron. Think about that. They can get a lot done. It doesn't have to go through the wheels of grinding, and it has to go to middle management, upper management. Empower your people to do that. So be very trusting. And so now, why is it now? Why do they crave empathy now more than ever? Because think of our world right now. Job uncertainty. We know we're lacking in hospitality people coming in. PTM programs are potentially going out. There's not a lot of people that want to work weekends, evenings, holidays in our world like we might have done back in the day, because they feel overworked, right? They're just, you know, it's not all about the work anymore. The stress from the work that we have, you know, think about the new mental anguish ideas and what's happening in sports and everything else like that, the mental health portion of it all. It translates all the way down to your employees. You don't have to be a world-class athlete to feel stress from what you do. Overwhelmed with the change, mask wearing, the pandemic, all so many things have changed, and that's coming up here with health and safety concerns. We never had to think about those things for our employees, but they need to feel that we are valuing their protection and not just for the members, but for also for the employees. They're not sure what to believe. Why? Because there's inconsistencies within the media. Who knows what to believe anymore? I don't. I look at one network versus the other network, one paper versus the other. It's totally different and conflicting ideas. So they're struggling. So maybe open chat, sitting down with them, hearing what their thoughts are, maybe straightening out, you know, a little more clarity on the other side. Who knows? And this is all related to of course, our world right now. And feeling underappreciated and undervalued is the number one thing, as we said. Certainly with the Gen Zs that are coming up, that is the number one thing. Employees, let me just move this over. Wanting to, let's see here. What can we do? What can we do with our employees? Of course, these are just practical ideas that you can maybe take in the workplace and see if you can change the culture to be a little bit more on the servient leadership side, on the heartfelt leader side. Have regularly staffed meetings, one-on-one. So many times people say they're not getting enough attention. They might get attention from a middle manager or something, but not from you. So schedule the times. Have chances for anonymous feedback. There's all sorts of apps out there now that are for members, but also for employees, where they can simply say on the course of the day, I enjoyed working at the club today, yes or no. Or a member is, I would recommend this club to my best and dearest friend, yes or no. It takes 10 seconds to fill it out. All sorts of ones out there right now that you could actually jump on board. Team building, you know, this was one of the things that I actually liked doing, so it wasn't hard for me, but I really enjoyed taking my staff out on a regular monthly basis. Let them choose where they want to go, take them out, get them away from the club. It's one of the key things now for not only team building, but also getting your boards and your tennis committees away from the club, because everything is too much geared about what's happening today at the club. We can't see all the good things that are happening at other clubs. Well, it's the same with your employees. Take them away to another club. Let's see what the other clubs are doing with their employees. Let's have a really good look, see how they're smiling when they greet. Let's see if there's any tips that we can pick up that are good for not only the employees, but for the patrons and the members. Carmen down at Mediterra, they just spent, I don't want to be quoted on the amount, but I believe it was multi-million dollars on creating an environment as important to employees as it is to members. Lounges, TV rooms, work rooms, great team dining experiences. I mean, this was one of the most beautiful experiences that I've seen in our world. And they actually, Carmen actually did a video on it to show. It was done with Peacock and Lewis Design. They spared no expense and created something really special. You don't need to do all that, of course, but can you make something special for your employees? You know, we talked about this a little bit, in a safe space to have open discussions. You know, are they allowed to freely talk and not have their head bit off? Now, if that has to be on paper, but they should be able to come and talk to you in a one-on-one situation, and you should be able to listen. And of course, everything that comes in has got to be responded to. Don't let it lie. Don't let it just sit there. Make sure there's a response. Participate in training workshops and having open discussions. Okay, so like we said, leaving the grounds sometimes. Maybe it's a Zoom call if you can't all get everybody together. And there's a theme that day. You know, there's a funny hat day. Brings everybody together. Everybody's got a one rare funny hat. And we talk about something that's pertinent to either them as a staff or the membership. This was all sourced by Ernest Young last year. When and if you invest in your team, you know, this is literally what you're going to see from Ernest and Young. Very specific rises in productivity. And let me tell you, the best operating clubs in America are doing this. You'll see increases in efficiency, creativity, innovation, company revenue, increase in productivity amongst employees. You will see this when you are a servant and heart-led leader. I remember Dick Copeland would always say something about, look, you know, let's pick a topic and put a cup in the middle of the room and or a cup with you, and you have to put in as many ideas on any topic that you might pick. Let's say it's to get new members at your club, and you work together and you put in three ideas on how to get new members. And then you pair up in a group of three, four, five of the employees all together, and you work out of the same cup. There's 15, 20 ideas. Just changes the whole dynamic of what you're looking for. Current trends in the workforce. Now, we do summits for CMAA club managers. We do summits for the PGA. We do summits for club presidents. And these are usually the top 50 club presidents, GMs, and PGAs. We're talking about doing that for the rackets profession in 2023. And Jeff Morgan came out with a very, very impressive set of statistics. So I said, Jeff, can I borrow some of these? He goes, Len, I'd be honored. So I just throw this at you to give it a little more idea of where we are in this whole great resignation, what we're paying our industry and the rackets industry, et cetera. So we know that at least up until this past month, and it might kick again now that what's happening in today's world, as in literally today's world, over 3.5 million Americans are leaving their job every month. A lot are in the hospitality and tourism because, let's face it, they don't want to work weekends, holidays, and evenings. And if they're not getting the love that they should be getting or want to get from their bosses, their GMs, and even their members, you're going to have the exodus. This is a good idea just quickly about workforce realignment, okay? So as you can see, even young ones are retiring. We work on the phone a lot, trying to source candidates for various jobs around the country. And I will call a candidate in the North Shore of Chicago, let's say, and at a very prominent club earning top dollar. And I'll hear from the club that, you know what? They're no longer working here. And I go, it's impossible. Finally get a hold of them. They say, look, we just wanted time off. I got two younger kids, didn't want to miss out on their education, didn't want to miss out on the experience of seeing them grow up. So I decided to take 1 or 2 years off, and I'll decide after 1 or 2 years if I'll go back. Now, think about that. 5 years ago, I would say you're out of your mind. You know, you should always have another job before you decided to resign from the job. But if you think about the demand for these positions now, they might actually be right. As a matter of fact, they are right, because the demand is so high, they could probably take a year or two off and still have 5 job offers when they come back, because that's the market right now. So they probably are doing it. If there was a time they want to see their kids, they want to get to know their spouse again, then sure enough, this might be the time to do it. So you can see some of the statistics there. This one I find very interesting, because if you look at leisure and hospitality at the top, it's had the highest increase in the last year than any other trade or any other profession. If you see it on the top, leisure and hospitality. What's wrong with that picture? It's the lowest paying dollar amount of any other industry. So yes, we're getting higher very quickly because we had to. We were so far behind that we're paying under what we should be. So if we take a little bit of a club benchmarking, who was one of our partners, and we listen to two statistics that they did for us just in the last few months. Number one, they said in 2022, if you didn't go up 10% across the board on your budget, you will be behind 2021. That's not just for labor and payroll. That's across the board from inflation, supply chains, and labor. So think about that. If your club didn't go up 10%, and let's say they went up 5%, they're now going to be 5% behind 2021. But somehow you're going to have to make it up. That's the one statistic. The other statistic, they're saying 25%, you have to think about 25% increase in labor costs over the next 3 years. 25%, you're going to have to go up over the next 3 years to break even from where you were in 2021. Staggering, mind-boggling. Staggering. Think about that. Because 57% of an average budget in the club world, in the member equity world, 57% is payroll. So if we're going to have to go up 25%, that's pretty staggering. But again, you should be telling your boards, your GM, if they don't know it already, these are the kind of things that you need to be telling, because you're going to need more money to hire this year, next year, and the year after. So what are employees asking themselves? I'm in a job that pays, significantly. Is there an outlet for my passions at work? I had a good chat with one of my key employees, John Sabia, today at the New Canaan Racquet Club. Again, I'm not there too much, but I love the club. We're doing really well, so I want to be a part of it. And he goes, yeah, if I didn't get a chance to play tennis and hit some balls every other day, Len, I'm not sure I would stay here. I said, well, good. Keep hitting balls whenever there's an open court. And he's gotten really good. He was not from a professional background. He was just, a novice player. And he's now actually hitting really, really well. Do I have enough time to pursue the external things that I like? you know, we know that all employees now have to be W-2 employees in a 501c7 nonprofit. Some are still not, but they're all supposed to be. So that means they're really only supposed to work 40 hours a week unless they're exempt. If they're exempt, of course, they can work a few more hours. But, you know, 40 hours a week for the rank and file employees is standard now. So that'll allow them to do some other things that are hobby-ish type things, allow them to enjoy life, the work-life balance. Whoops, let's keep going the other way. What does it all go back to? I only threw this in. You might have seen this slide from former presentations, prior presentations. It still holds true. And this is from 1954. You know, really, the top three are to focus on. You need a love and belonging. Okay, remember the word love. Friendship, family. You need esteem. And you can get to self-actualization, where this is a real career, a passionate career for yourself. Just thought I would throw that in because nothing has changed in many respects, even though we're saying the world has changed. So what can we do? You know, assessment, understand, whoops, sorry about that. Understand our new client at our club. If we're not thinking about what a Gen Z is, then we're going to be left behind. So every decision that you make, whether it's membership, classifications, what amenities you're offering, what activities and program you're offering, it's all about the Gen Zs now. They're going to be the next client. So we should always be thinking about them. If you take that on an employee basis, well, same thing. It's all about happiness first. They're not going to commit to a club for 30 years like in our era we did. Salary and benefits, work-life balance. So many Gen Zs are all about giving feedback. And, you know, mine are all on my, I do have one Gen Z who's graduating from Florida State this year. I'm very proud of her, Kelly. And, you know, she's all about giving feedback. And every place that she goes to, I want them to know that I didn't like that, or I thought that was great both ways. But I say, you know, just try and taper that a little bit, because it might come back to dear old dad here and I might catch some crap for it. So, you know, be gentle with that. But they're not as worried about money, but they have to have happiness with the money. They truly believe that happiness will end up where they get well taken care of and well paid for. So boards too, supporting what's going to happen. They have to make sure that they're budgeting correctly, just like we talked about. So real fast, this is sort of our world right now. You know, again, you might have seen this statistic before, but this is really fast, very simple. It plays into everything we've been saying for more than 10 years. What's everybody looking for from the board or GM side for a director of tennis or head pro? If you can see this very, very, I know it's small. Number one, virtually every single time on our culture surveys, which we do before we start a search, we want to know exactly what the club is looking for before we start a search. Henceforth, our very high success rate of placements. It is leadership, direction for staff, including hiring and training expertise. Wow. That's just it in another way that you can see it a little bit better, but a 9.68 out of 10. That's an average club survey statistic. Number one, 9.68. So do you need to know how to hire? I'll say. So a little things to help with that. What do you look for in candidates? Are they passionate about what they do? Things are changing now. I think the number one thing that you know, we make as errors of as hiring experts, whether you're a head pro hiring assistants or director hiring head pros or GMs hiring either one of the positions, we tend to talk too much about what the role is and not assume that the candidate should have done their due diligence and already know what the role is. And we need to try and find who they are, because guess what? We need to hire also passionate, caring, servient, heart-led people. So here's a list of things that you might want to make sure that you know if this is not on their resume. So here might be a few questions. Ask yourself right now. Think about it. What are the top three questions that you might be thinking about when you're going to interview a potential employee or a potential team member? You know, I can think of a few that I always asked for 25 years, and they weren't these. What's important to you? What is it that is important to you? Can you give me an example of when you showed somebody appreciation? Think about how much you can learn from these answers. Can you share an experience where you made a mistake, but then grew from it and overcame it? We're all going to make mistakes. That's the beauty thing about, you know, the Ritz-Carlton and St. Regis and all the top chains. They all know they're going to make mistakes. That's why they've empowered their frontline people, but they have to make sure they correct the mistake. We're all going to make mistakes. Let's just get it right the next time. So these are questions that you might not have been thinking about in an interview. I'm going to play something too. So, you know, what's really important, and we said hiring, training, expertise, and retention of employees, because retention of employees right now, I think if you lose an employee, the average price is 50% of what their salary or in or commission. So if they're earning $100,000, it costs you about $50,000 to replace that employee. On a higher end, I remember a great manager of mine at Boca Lago, Jean Paul Stifter, at one time, and this was going back 20 years ago, he blurts out this thing. He goes, by the way, your value to our company right now is it's $250,000. And I go, what in heaven's name does that mean? He says, by the time we could hire you, train you to get where you are, where you know every program, know every member, know our culture, you know the senior staff so well, know how everything runs so smoothly, it would cost us $250,000 to replace you. That was 20 years ago. Probably double that, maybe $500,000. So we have to make sure that we won't always be able to check off every box in an employee anymore. But one of the things that are very valuable, this is from Holly Bellotti, who's a wonderful GM who we just did a director of racket search with. And I just saw her a couple days ago at CMA in San Diego. And I won't play the whole thing, but I'll start off with just a little piece in the beginning. But onboarding of new members, making sure of new team members, not members. They do have something for members too, but this is actually an onboarding concept for new employees. And it goes into a little bit about, who they are, giving a little bit about the club and their amenities and things like that.
Bayhead Yacht Club was founded in 1888, originally for rowing and water sports. Since then, it's evolved into a large social, tennis, and sailing club. There are 11 acres of campus that include the clubhouse, a junior sailing hub, boat storage, 10 tennis courts, 4 paddle courts, a paddle hut, and 2 maintenance buildings.
Now we go to this part here. Of course, they get involved with some of the
Bayhead Yacht Club Foundation is run completely by a group of committed members who really care to make a difference and show the overall appreciation of the staff.
Listen to what they're saying about the staff.
Contribute to the fund that allows our employees in college or applying to colleges to receive a scholarship. It's a very nice way of saying thank you for everything you do all summer and all year. Our office staff can be helpful in explaining more about this unique opportunity and the foundation itself.
The members are very excited to meet you. They want to be part of your life. They want to enjoy their experience with you.
We all are striving to have the greatest environment for the members and the workers, and I really love that.
Everyone is very friendly with us and very appreciative of all the hard work we do for them.
At BHYC, we go the extra mile. We work hard every day to build relationships with the members and anticipate their wants and needs. The most important part of your new job at BHYC will be making smiles and making wow moments.
We're here to make sure that the members have a pleasant experience.
To put on the best show you can, it's about making the members happy and about truly enjoying where you work. Their satisfaction is your satisfaction.
Now, if that isn't powerful, everybody could do something that so easily at their club, whatever it is. Get your culture out there to a new person who understands it, wants to be part of it. They see even the membership putting in funds towards their success. It's not based on their just who they are. It's based on them being a family member. And that's so critical. So it's a great idea on that. So we're almost done, but just, you know, we really were done there. As a leader, the most powerful motivator for a team is a simple thank you. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for being part of our team. Thank you for who you are. And these are all very good quotes and ideas for you to consider. While you're reading those, I want to do a simple exercise. And I want you to think of the best leader that you've ever worked for. Get that person in your mind. Then I want you to think of one of the more challenging leaders that you ever worked for. In layman's terms, somebody that really wasn't a good leader. And I want you to have two baskets or something. We did this with a big board. And on the one board on the left, on the heading, it said things like, this leader knows my name, knows the family members of, knows my name of all the family members. They ask about where I want to be and they understand my career goals. They meet with me regularly. And then they set career goals for me with them. Every year, redoing those goals over and over again. On the other side, very reputable, but you've got a person who has great pedigree, might have every degree known to mankind. They might have two MBAs. They might have CCM. They might be speakers. They might be highly regarded in their professional association. They might serve on various boards. They said, take that one person that you think was your best leader and put them on which side would they go? Think about that. So in closing, which side would you rather be on as a leader? With that, I thank you. If you want the presentation, we certainly can. And here's, if you want to shoot this is a great way to reach me. It gives you all my contact information on the RQ code. And I guess, Pat, at this time, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Well, Len, I thank you. This was fantastic. We really don't have any questions, and we're pretty much out of time too. So if anybody does have a question, I'd say reach out to you directly, but thank you so much. This was fantastic.
Much appreciated. And thanks for having me. Everybody stay well and enjoy the rest of the year. And let's make it a special one for all of us. We have a chance to really take this boom of rackets and continue it into 2023.
Amen.